Whenever we make a drawing of somebody or take a picture of somebody, we are representing them in a certain way. The real person is already there. In the way you draw, in the way you take a picture, angle, color, light and all that, you are representing that person. So the other person also is very conscious how he or she is being projected. Especially if I am putting up an image in Facebook, you want to put up the right kind of image. You know, all the hair in correct place, smiling, no negative emotions coming through. So you want the outer world to see the best in you and in a certain angle that you think is right for you. Right? That's why most of the time we keep rejecting the pictures taken by others. This doesn't look like me, this is not right, that is not right. So it's a constant struggle to find that one image which will represent you as you think is the correct. So therein lies the problems of representation. In a sense, many times you are not in control of how you are being projected or how you are being represented in images, in paintings, in posters, advertisements and so on. As an individual or as a set of people or as a group, there are many types or many fixed ways of looking at people, looking at individuals can be seen in images. So the question I am trying to take up in this segment is that how one is represented. Can there be, you know, a problem in that, or there can be issues there? And are those images which are being projected, are they static or are they mutable, are they fluid? Like 10 times you see a picture of somebody crying, then you try to expect that 11th time also the same kind of image from that person. Or the politicians are projected in a certain way again and again in a media, then you would expect that image type to continue. So can those images be subverted? Can those images be rearranged or re-looked at or reimagined? So these are the kind of questions I am going to address in this segment. In oil color, there is this color called flesh tint, which actually comes from Europe. So the flesh tint that is sold in the market matches the flesh tint of the white people, their lighter skin tone, and then that is also sold in India as flesh tint. Now the question is, whose flesh tint are we using as a color to paint? And because of our colonial experience, we have a great fascination for fairer skin, which is again and again seen in paintings, posters, in all walks of our life. These are Ravi Verma's prints, and you will see the people with power, people who are people who are higher in the level in society, they are normally projected as fair skin, and people who are low caste or people who are economically backward are shown as dark skin. So similar kind of association you can see here also. Sita is sitting in the Ravana's palatial surroundings, and the people who are guarding her are shown in dark skin. And over a period of time, the darkness has also become something that is evil. The color dark also speaks about somebody who is not good. So all these associations actually, in a way, muddle up the process of representation. Now, the kind of images Ravi Verma produced of gods and goddesses, they are all fair-skinned. Because the kind of models he was using, and also the kind of European paintings which he was inspired by, they spoke that language. And then he adopted that, and he has painted the gods and goddesses of Indian mythology, and you will see the in the anatomical detail and the way they are represented, they are very different from the kind of skin color we see around mostly. Now there are some campaigns where they are trying to change the color of the goddess and then reimagining the image of goddess in different ways, and that has got into bit of resistance also, because as I said before, once you start representing certain images in one way, there is an expectation that that tradition and the same repetition will happen again and again. The kind of fascination for fair skin continues in advertisements. It's a multi-million dollar industry, and they entice you with all kinds of results. If you use their products, you will become fairer, then you will become successful in life, you will get jobs, you will get a girlfriend, and so on. So that is something that has been accepted by the society, and some of these fairness creams are sold in very small sachets or very small quantities, so that even the lower economic group people can buy that cream, and through that buying the cream, you are also buying a certain aspiration, certain dream of becoming a fair-skinned person and then becoming attractive and so on. All the narratives continue there. And for a long time, it was only the ladies who are expected to be fair-skinned, and the recent time, even men are being targeted with such products. You will see that in the kind of advertisement that are put up for bride and groom and all that, and very typically they will say wheatish complexion. That is something, an ideal kind of color that you are looking for in your partner, with along with all the other traditional, homely, and so on, other kind of values which come as part of the. So you will very clearly see that you are crossing over that line and then becoming fairer and fairer. And off late, there is a lot of resistance for this kind of products. Many celebrities refuse to endorse them, but still the sale has not dipped. Historically also, when paintings were done in Europe, the lady of the house or the aristocratic lady was shown that was the kind of power relationship that was there. Somebody with a dark skin would be serving in the house. The kind of slavery that was prevalent started showing up in these paintings and imagery. And when Aishwarya Rai recently did one campaign where the similar kind of language was imitated or adopted, there was huge resistance. And then they had to drop the campaign because it was racist. It was very, it didn't show the dark-skinned people in the right light. This campaign, which was done by Taproot Agency, they were trying to bring awareness about domestic abuse. So we say women in India are goddess. They are devis and they are worshipped. They are looked after well and all that, but the incidence of domestic abuse is rising. So the agency created this campaign where the image of Lakshmi and Saraswati, they were shown in such a way that there has been a scuffle, or they were beaten, and that kind of imagery came up, and they also revealed how those were made. This is very interesting because if you are a believer, then you look at these images in a very different way. And if you have a very critical view, then you tend to see the image of gods and goddesses as being a construct. That is civilization, and the artist being one of the person who is involved in creating those kind of images. Until Ravi Verma came into picture, if you had to see the image of God, then you had to go into a temple. You could not just see it anywhere. And if you are from a lower caste family, you could never enter the temple. And because Ravi Verma started printing them and selling them at a very cheap rate, these images started entering the house. And people started imagining them in the way that Ravi Verma was showing them. So this is the kind of history that this campaign was trying to subvert, which again got into a lot of controversy because the kind of representation and the reverence shown to images was being subverted there. The images also bring a certain value system. They are not just images. They will tell you the position of the wife in the household, where she has to sit, or what she has to aspire for. The story of Satyava and Savitri, or the way they show Sita sitting at the foot of Rama and pressing his legs, or the Shakuntala kind of story, where again you are narrating a certain value system through these images. So the artists have again and again tried to intervene in those storytelling and try to reimagine the kind of values that are being proposed by these images. Chitra Ganesh uses the kind of Amar Chitrakatha language, and the images look very much like a cartoon strip, but the kind of content she inserts in is a taboo in the Amar Chitrakatha kind of storytelling, because she talks about lesbian relationships and other kind of taboo subjects which are never spoken in public and always spoken about in a very hushed voice. Atul Dodia uses the images of popular prints and posters, and also the kind of image that is seen in the Bollywood movie, to bring a sense of the kind of value system that India lives with. And many times it's very contradictory. We say one thing and we do another thing, and the images speak something else. So this kind of contradiction he starts bringing into the fore in his painting. In schools, they display the kind of charts which talk about good manners, or ideal boy, ideal girl, and so on, which will tell you what is the right kind of value system you have to live by. So you have to be always reverential about elders, or you can't do this, you can do this, and if you do this, you'll get into trouble. Good manners, bad manners, all these are prescribed value systems which come to the children in their childhood through these charts. And they are not very expensive, so they are brought very easily and then displayed in all places. So it builds a certain expectation of how you should dress, how you should behave, what you should do and what you should not do. And in a similar vein, there are charts which tell you about how a lady, if she is not well-mannered, what kind of suffering she has to go through in hell. So it becomes like a prescription what she will have to go through, and she will be it's a chart which brings a certain sense of fear. So you have two opposite poles which are controlling. One is you give them, if you behave well, this is what will happen, that is the reward that you are going to get, and if you don't behave well, what is the kind of punishment you will get. So this chart in detail prescribe the society's expectation from an individual. This was a project done by the Srishti school students, and they tried to reimagine the kind of charts or subvert the kind of content of these charts. So the bad girl is one who lets her hair down, or she rides a vehicle, or she smokes. So it is the opposite of what the society in general expects a girl to behave in a certain way. It almost questions every kind of value that is being prescribed by the kind of chart that is in circulation. Now, what is shown in a chart is as important as what is not shown. And if you look at the titles of this, it says occupations and our helpers, and you will see most of them are occupied by men. And when it comes to women, they do different kind of work. They are in the kitchen, they are always cooking, they are bringing water. So there is a kind of representation or the kind of fixed image that the society is bringing onto the role a woman has to play. And this is the kind of painting we saw, how fixed the role of a woman in society is being projected through those paintings. And this is the image of Rabri Devi, who was the ex-chief minister of Bihar. So you would expect a different kind of image making when related to a chief minister. But she is still seen as a woman, and then when she is projected in the media many times, you will see her cooking. Not somebody who is sitting in power or somebody, commanding the respect of all the people around her. And especially the kind of chart here, the not only the woman, the daughter is also in a way reflecting the mother's work. She is helping her in the kitchen, she is helping her in sweeping the floor. See here. So it says uses of water, and almost half of them, the woman is working, cleaning, and then washing clothes and so on. The boy is enjoying. There are many campaigns which have started now to reimagine these kind of situations so that the boys also become more and more aware of the kind of bias that is being built around. This says woman at work. And you don't see, women have been presidents of India. They have been the prime minister of India, but you don't see that. You see them in very small occupations, which are of not much significance in the bigger running of the country. So that's why I said what is shown is as important as what is not being shown, or what kind of expectations and value systems these charts bring into the people's mind. And this will get extended if you see the kind of serials that we see in TV. The way they dress and the way they are confined to the home atmosphere, or the kind of small quarrels that happen at home, and the way they dress in a very traditional way, even though they are very educated, and all kinds of other value systems come through in the TV serials, and across the language barrier, they all reflect each other now. This was a painting by Manet. It was called Luncheon on the Grass, and when it was done, it created quite a bit of controversy because the men are clothed and only she is nude. And over a period of time, women have been used in advertisement in nude, in semi-clad, and various ways of sensational ways. Now there are some campaigns which are trying to subvert that, reverse that image making. Can, in advertisement where women's dress are being propagated, can a man be used as an object or object of desire, or as a side prop, or just somebody who is just passing in the side, and so on. And these kind of projects are not accepted so easily because the expectations are entrenched in the society. It is not only about individual people that the images get frozen, and then you are not ready to accept them portrayed, represented in different ways. Now Gandhi, we always want Gandhi's image to be shown in a certain way. Otherwise it is not accepted, and there are a lot of trouble that builds up around that. Vivek Vilasini has done a project. He has gone to many villages, districts of rural India, and then he starts taking pictures. And because these sculptures are made by artists who are not so well trained or skilled, the kind of Gandhi statues that you see, more than Gandhi, they start looking like old people, just wearing one rimmed glass, and then aging, and then with bald head. But still we accept, as far as the three or four iconographic details are there in that old man. That is how during the October 2nd and all that, there are some old people who put a lot of silver on the face, and with a danda they come and they enact the role of Gandhi. So this is a kind of humanizing the image of Gandhi and also trying to reimagine the Gandhi as an ordinary person, as an old man just around the corner. This is a sculpture which is in Delhi, which is about the Dandi March, when Gandhi led people to go to Dandi and pick up a pinch of salt against the mighty British government. And now Gigi Scaria has done a digital work where people are abandoning him and moving away in a different direction. So it's a very different kind of narrative that is being built up, as again as the kind of very reverential and way you look up to Gandhi. So there is a questioning here about the kind of role that Gandhi is playing in our lives in today's time. Deepanjana Rai creates sculptures of Gandhi in situations which are only imaginary. Like if Gandhi was today, would he use a lot of internet instead of kind of newspapers which he published and circulated to bring up the movement, Indian independence movement? He would have been using Twitter and Facebook and Instagram and all that. But we can't imagine him like that, because our image of Gandhi is frozen and is set at a certain stage in a certain way. And these sculptures, and some of these were supposed to be shown in the governor's house in Bangalore a few years ago, and the governor refused to show them. He said, "This cannot be shown. This is not the way you show or represent Gandhi. It should be respectful, and you can't play around or you can't joke about him," and so on. But people from my generation are able to relate to the kind of, because we are in a way much more free to imagine Gandhi in different ways. Now Gandhi is always shown walking very swiftly with his danda, but here he is resting, and that too on a lazy bhai sofa, not any other kind of sofa, a lazy bhai sofa. That is a contradiction. And Gandhi is a man who proposed non-violence. All his sculptures that Deepanjana does is on red color, and then he goes around with a dog wearing jeans. So it is humorous, but it is also questioning our habits of looking at people in a very fixed ways. So from time to time, there are instances where history is rewritten. And when the Soviet regime fell in Russia, the Lenin statues were demolished. And recently there was a controversy about Periyar statue, which was vandalized in Tamil Nadu. Or many times you see in many villages, they create barricades around statues of Ambedkar, Gandhi, and Periyar and all that, so that it is not destroyed, or somebody will go and put up a chapel garland and things like that. Tiruvalluvar statue was supposed to be revealed, rather it was supposed to be inaugurated in Bangalore. Tiruvalluvar is a Tamil poet, but the Kannada organizations did not let it happen. So for years together, that statue was covered in white cloth and it was kept there. Everybody knew it is Tiruvalluvar statue, but until a politician opens the, and reveals the statue, we, believe that it is not there. Only when the Sarvagna statue was put up in Tamil Nadu beach, then the Tiruvalluvar statue was unveiled in Bangalore. In history, there is also a trend in erasing people and their memory. Hitler, Mao, Stalin, all of them, whenever they fell out with somebody, all the photographs in the archives, that person would be removed from the photographs. So like in another segment, I told you about the stories of people who are erased from memory, or people who are never remembered. That is one kind of issue. Here, because you are in power, you see to it that person is not remembered or is erased from the history books. And that is not just done as a concept, but visually the photographs are altered so that those persons are removed from there. And then finally one person will remove, everybody is gone. In India, we are fond of creating statues of living people, or people who are very famous, or people who are very popular, and so on. So you have temples and statues. There is a temple for Mahatma Gandhi in Tamil Nadu. There are statues of Godse and MGR. Because Sonia Gandhi was instrumental in creating Telangana, the people of Telangana has made a statue of her, and then it is installed in Telangana. And once you create the statue, there are other stories which build up around that. And then it becomes very difficult to reimagine them in different ways. So that is the problem with representation. We tend to imagine states and our country also as a mother goddess. So recently when Telangana was, Andhra and Telangana were separated, two images were created, one for Andhra and one for Telangana. The only difference is this, they exchange the hands in which they hold the, Kalasham. And we also have one for the Kannada Thai, Bhuvaneshwari. They all look very similar, only small iconographic details are shifted from here to there. And it doesn't remain just as a painting on a paper. It becomes a statue, then it becomes a power which can move the state, and then it can create a lot of trouble also. We imagine our country as mother, but there are other countries which imagine their country as father. They call fatherland, we say motherland. Avanindranath Tagore imagined the Bharat Mata in 1905. And when he did that, she had very different kind of iconographic detail in her hand. It was about meditation, it was about harvest, it was about education, and it was about being pure because of the white cloth she was having in her hand. And then later, the image started shifting. Over a period of time, the image was modified again and again, and then of late, it has become very aggressive. Of course, this trend also started quite some time ago, but it has become more and more aggressive now. And you will see that the Indian flag, which she is holding, has changed also now. In some of the popular posters, the flag in her hand has changed. Now, is it possible to imagine the Bharat Mata in different ways, other than what the popular prescription tells you? Just imagine there is an artist involved in creating that image. The kind of women he saw, or the kind of dressing he saw around him, he has projected on that, or he has incorporated in that. So what if there is a mother goddess, or the Bharat Mata, who comes from Northeast? How will she look? Or if she is from the Muslim community, what that Bharat Mata will look like? Or what if the mother, the Bharat Mata is from a labor class, which is a working lady, how will that Bharat Mata look? It is a problematic issue, because as I said before, the image of Bharat Mata at the moment is frozen, and it is expected to be seen in a certain way. And it is not easy to shift from that position. But attempts are being made by artists again and again to make it more mutable, make it more porous. This is an image by B.K. Swarma, who is imagining Bharat Mata as very benign, very kind, so people can come to her and so on, which is very different from the kind of Bharat Mata with lots of lions around her. So these images keep changing from time to time, and then people who are doing research, they follow them and then try to figure out why at a certain juncture of history, certain kind of images are being imagined. Lastly, Pushpamala recreates the popular imagery which is seen in posters and photographs. This is an earlier image of Bharat Mata, where Bhagat Singh is offering his head as a tribute to her. So she has recreated that in her work, and thereby she is bringing our attention to the fact these images are a construct of a society, of a people and a culture. If you have enjoyed watching this video, please press like button. To see more such videos, subscribe to our channel. Thank you.